we're going to survive, we need a new kind of soldier. If you succeed, you will be remembered as a hero.
Now!
Over 50 years ago, the Earth was attacked by a race of aliens. Though millions were lost, Earth eventually won. Now they live in preparation for another attack, training kids from a very young age for war. One of these young kids is a brilliant mind known as Ender Wiggin.
The good.
Though odd at first, the story setup was pretty good once given context. Though much of their training does involve traditional military style and behavior, children are trained through war games. The reason for this is because starting from a very young age, playing games is something that most kids find enjoyment in. As such, if they're educated this way throughout their life, the process of war and its tactics will become a natural thing for the brain. As such, these kids will eventually become better generals or soldiers, as opposed to someone who became a part of the military in their teenage or adult years. The roster of actors they picked, including Harrison Ford, Asa Butterfield, and Haley Steinfeld, were well selected, and Moises Arias, most famous for his role as Rico in Hannah Montana, is also in this movie. I won't give away the person he plays, but my god. He has come far as an actor since Hannah Montana. One of the primary war games featured is a zero-gravity game in which the goal is to capture the other opponent's base or to score as many points as possible on the other team. This game is played in a zero-gravity field with several obstacles, two teams, and stun guns. The scenes featuring this game were probably the most entertaining, and I want to see this in real life someday. I like the way this movie covers the intense themes about war and the idea of training kids for war. Characters in this movie debate about how this training should be handled, and there are some seedy things going on behind the scenes, manipulating the circumstances about what the children are or are not told in the midst of their training. This manipulation pays off to certain key moments in the film. The Iffy. I'd like to make it clear right now, I haven't read the book upon which this movie is based. I did, however, go to the movie with a friend of mine who is a big fan of the book. And in her opinion, they adapted it pretty well. There were a couple notable arcs in the movie that were cut, but she says that this was probably for good reason, or just to not make the movie unnecessarily long. Then we come to Orson Scott Card, the author of the book. Because of Orson Scott Card's negative views on homosexuality, a boycott was declared on this film by much of the LGBT community. In my opinion, the views of the creator should not instigate a boycott on the movie. Rather, it should be something in the movie itself. I respect both sides' rights to have their own opinion on things. You can do whatever you feel like. It's your money. You don't have to spend it on this movie if you really don't want to. The Bad. During the film, Ender and his brother Peter go through a certain story arc based on Ender wanting not to become like his brother. But since his brother is only featured in one scene in the entire movie, this arc feels a little downplayed and not very strong. Much of this movie is composed of training as opposed to any real conflict. From this, one could say not a whole lot is happening in this movie, so it's hard to get invested in. The Verdict? It is true that not a lot of real conflict happened in this movie. But the journey leading up to the real conflict was really good. It had dark themes that were explored during this time, the character interactions were good, and the environment this movie was set in was really cool. This is Detective Steve, and it's nice to see Harrison Ford back up in space. Now he just needs to stop beating around the bush and say yes to Star Wars Episode 7.